WebCon, and you will get to see her other times as well. But for our track, we're very pleased that she's here. And we've got, oh, is it okay if I hold up your book and show everybody? she's going to probably be answering questions about that as well. Everyone, please welcome the incomparable Felicia Day.
Robbie created this character that was so beautiful on the page, and in fact, I couldn't take a job the month that they actually approached me many years ago to do this part, and when I read the script, I was like, well, I'm doing it! It was the month that I was launching my company, and after, you know, I was like, definitely not the time to be adios, I'm going to Canada, but I read the script, and it was just amazing role, and it was so, it felt like a glove, and it also represented all the things that I love about female characters, which is that she was smart and capable and empathetic, and she showed her warts in a way, and then she happened to be geeky and a lesbian, and I just love that. She wasn't defined by those sort of stereotypes that we sort of check the box in sometimes in television. Lesbian, check. We got, you know, the geek, check. I don't like that because we're not defined by those things about us. We are much more. And he was able to embody a character I couldn't wait to play, and I got to do it for many years. So, as far as your question, I guess we should go back to that. You know, I don't know the details. I guess, I guess schedule-wise, I was in three episodes in the spring, so I don't know if it was just a scheduling thing. You can ask him on Twitter, but...
I'm going to, I'm just saying.
Yeah. I guess it would have been nice to have him be in his hands, but I'm sure they did the best that they could with the schedule that they could. It's almost nice that Charlie is still alive in his writer's heart, in a way. Spoiler alert. Nobody ran screaming, you can't be mad at me.
And I kept hoping that there's got to be a way around this. Who else thought that? I mean, how many of us were you hoping that?
I mean, you never know. I've been in a lot of genre. That's what I love. I love being in shows like that. I'm being killed by the best. I mean,
that's right.
I'm turning into the Sean Bean of women. So. It's almost like I got my thing, guys. I got my thing. There's always a faint hope, and you never know. Like, they even said, I guess the head of Warner Brothers was like, you never know, no one's ever really dead. I mean, I was kind of thinking, oh, bring me back, and then they burn my body, so. I know. So I was like, well, not the way you thought. fine. You know, like, when you're on a TV show, you can't, you're just part of their overall story. And, you know, I was blessed to be on the show as long as I did. So I just will always love Robbie because he created this awesome character I love and I got to play.
Well, we all loved him. Now, the relationship between Charlie and Dean was so special. That was something just, I think it was something he really needed. And, you know, not and as well as Charlie. And do you have any comments about that whole thing? Or, you know, how did that affect you, or, you know, the character and you as an individual?
Yeah, I really love the relationship that evolved between Dean and Charlie. And, you know, she's a really interesting character. We get a lot of her backstory about how she really has kept herself secret her whole life. And she's never been her authentic self to anyone. And there's this interesting parallel between her and the boys, who are always on the run. They're never being able to be who they are and settle into themselves and be authentically part of a group, in a sense. And, you know, obviously Castiel adds that and makes a family. But having Charlie sort of be a part of that and feel accepted as a person, I think that's what really drove her to want to be a hunter, to want to be with in their group and belong sort of to this really awesome, almost family unit. I mean, because we love the Scooby Gangs, right? We love Buffy and that group. Part of wanting to belong, and I think those are the kind of shows when you have a family that you feel like, oh, they belong together and they help each other in through their worst and their best times. That was what really was awesome, to be able to be for Charlie to be herself completely with another person or people, with Sam and Dean especially.
Do we have some questions? We're in the audience. We've got, where is she?
Sheila.
There she is. All
right. You're sweating. Absorbing things? Okay. Sorry, I don't mean to call her.
Hi, Pete, you're welcome to DirectCon. Congratulations on your best-selling book.
Thank you, guys. If you see me on social media, you're probably surprised I have a book, because I haven't posted about it at all. I'm just kidding. Number 3 on the New York Times bestseller list, guys. In my book, I talk a lot about how I was raised, and I was raised as a homeschool kid, and didn't really have a lot of friends. I was kind of isolated, playing video games, reading fantasy novels, and watching TV, and my mom grew me in a bubble. Kind of like, you know, one of those little things where you put succulents and you just hang it there, and you're like, no, that's great. That's how I grew up. So I definitely have always been on the outside looking in my life. And I do think that that helped inform Charlie because, you know, her backstory wasn't totally filled out when I saw her on the page at first, but certainly that sense that she had secrets because she was a hacker, she was stealing money and funneling it from a corporation into a charity, and, you know, all these other little things. And, you know, I did associate with that sort of having a part of you hidden or not accepted by everybody. And I think that's part of the beautiful journey that she went through, is that she was able to show that hidden part of her and be honest with people in her life, like Sam and Dean. And that's when she felt like, hey, I really want to stay in this world because I actually feel accepted. I feel clean in a sense that I've come clean to somebody and shown them all I am, and I'm not rejected for it. And I think that's something that is a universal in my life. Because I always have felt like kind of a weird person and an outsider, and it's a theme in my work, so that no one should ever feel like they need to keep a key part of themselves hidden in order to be accepted, because those people aren't really accepting you. So that's what's wonderful about Charlie and why it was so much fun playing her and peeling back her layers over the seasons. I can send you.
Hi, my name is Nan, and
Central fan, you know that Jared and Jensen are hilarious. They are some of the funnest people I've ever worked with. They create a family on set that's just unbelievable. They treat everyone as equals, and they are just genuinely wonderful people. And you know, I had a lot of fun with them. They would not prank me like they do Misha and Mark and all the other guys. You know, like trying to pull their pants down off camera, or like mess with them when they're like trying to do a serious scene and just like doing crazy faces to Misha. Just so funny. They did tease me a lot. Like Jared. Okay, let me. Jared makes fun of my hugs because. I do hug kind of weird. I hug like this. So this is how I hug, okay?
Hey, how's it going?
And I like, I don't know what it is. I'm wary of my pelvis touching my pelvis. I don't want to feel like I'm getting all up in their space, right? So I sort of like teepee it. And he's like, what's that fake hug? And I'm like, oh, I'm being respectful. And he's like, no, it's fake. So whenever he came up to me to hug me,
hey, Felicia.
Ridiculous. And it's even funnier because he's like the longest man in existence. He's 6'4", maybe 6'8", something like that. Yeah, somewhere in there. Somewhere up like, hey, what's up? That was pretty funny. And then Jensen is just so smart and so fascinating to talk to, and they're so educated about so many different things. Except for when they talked about golf, I would be like, yeah, a little bit, but that's just me. Listen, I can glaze somebody's eyes over a lot about a lot of things, you know? Want to talk about some Dragon Age romance arcs? I don't glaze your eyes over, that's why I like DragonCon. And then I guess I tell a story a lot about a certain episode because it was such a funny incident where, I don't know if you watched the episode where I played Good and Dark Charlie. Yeah. So, yeah, that was an amazing opportunity and very intimidating. I took it very seriously. And Dark Charlie was kind of a bee, you know? She's really up in her, in Dean's grill a lot. And there's a scene after she basically murders somebody after promising she would, she comes up and has a scene with Dean in the bar, and they're sitting like this, right? And in the script, it says Charlie reaches out and takes Dean's shot and throws it back. And I was like, oh shit, I haven't even done a shot. Because I'm not much of a drinker, because I get really obnoxious, and I'm just like, let's not. And I'm puffy the next day, and I'm like, well, I'm vain, so maybe I just won't drink that much. I'm always just sipping maybe a lady drink with my finger out, you know, believe me. So anyway, I was like, I gotta do this in the script. So I reach over during the scene and I go, and she's really being sassy and she's like, whatever. And then she goes, and like in the scene, I'm not kidding, I threw water all over my face. And I'm like, oh my God, the cameras are rolling. And rather than just being like, I'm sorry, we gotta stop, I just kept going. So I'm like, I mean, and then, you know, Jensen is such a professional, and he's been doing it so many years, he's just a great actor, and I've never seen him break, except during that moment, I saw just like, you would be able to, you could still use the take, you could totally use it, because he's such a pro, but I saw his mouth just quiver a little bit, and then it was cut, and he was like, what the hell? That's my best story on the set. Okay, next.
Hello. I was just curious, with how expansive the universe is in the show, what your favorite personal headcanon would be, either for Felicia or just the show in general?
My personal headcanon, like what I like the most?
Well, like headcanon being like, it'd be like a weird thing that maybe isn't like explicitly stated within the canon. Like, I don't know, like his favorite color is purple. I don't know. Maybe like a weird, maybe character trait that maybe wasn't explicitly said in the show, but you think would apply to the character.
Oh, like as far as, huh, that's interesting, like something that, wow, that's a really interesting question. I always thought that, you know, that Charlie always took weird lessons some places. Like she has a lot of random skills that she just let pop up. She'd be like, oh, I'm good at knives, you know? I know that she trained a lot in Oz and she came out back much more of a badass. But I always thought that she like knew how to, you know, knit really well. I feel like she kind of was one of those people who, but not in a like ladylike, you know, ladylike way. I think she was one of those people who knits things and puts them on trees. Like she's a vandal, but in a kind of innocuous way. I mean, that was something I always felt like, cause she's a rule breaker, and that's what I kind of loved about her. I'm always like, suddenly let's change the establishment a little bit. So I think she had that sort of slyness that, you know, she would always put like an indie book in the front of at the bookstore, like just switch them around, which you guys should totally do with my book. You're welcome. Sheila, come on. You should run to the other side just to get that headband.
Hi there, Felicia. I am curious about your improvisational background and how that has helped you with your character and in the world of Supernatural. Is there a lot of improv on the show? Just kind of speak on that.
Yeah, I've done a lot of improv comedy, and that's kind of what I, you know, kept me going all these years, because I love improv. I love being able to make up stuff and play with other people. And if I were to give anybody advice about how to start out as a creator, no matter what you want to create, I would totally recommend you take an improv class wherever you live, because it is really freeing, and it shows you that you have a lot more unconsciously inside of you than you would know. So a lot of us don't trust ourselves to know that there's something inside that we want to get out. And the improv classes kind of take that sort of that hat off that sort of suppresses our inner selves and lets us just blurt out fart jokes, you know, randomly. So, and you know, as applying for Supernatural, like on a TV show, generally you don't improv a lot. If you're a guest actor, if you're a regular actor, sometimes there's a little more leeway, especially on a comedy. But on Supernatural, you know, the scripts are done, they're approved, and they're all there, so there's no reason to sort of add anything, except for, you know, the inner life of the character. Like, you know, everything an actor does, like smiling or the way they look at somebody or the way they deliver a line is improv underneath the script that you get somebody. And that's something it took me a while to learn. Just because I have words I have to say doesn't mean I'm not improvising in my own head and out, you know, around the words. You know, that really was something that helps, especially when you're playing off somebody else. You're supposed to be looking at what they're giving you and sort of improvising and being able to fit in the scenes off of what they're giving you. And when you work with somebody like, you know, Jensen or Jared, and there's a beautiful scene in one of the last episodes I did where I talked with Jared about his relationship with Dean, you know, Sam's relationship with Dean, and we're alone in the cabin, and it was one of the most fun acting scenes I've ever done, because it was really serious and very earnest, and then, you know, Jared is just such a good actor, and to have that quiet moment finally between us as characters, really, I'm so glad that Charlie got to have that scene with Sam, because her relationship with Dean was so solid over the seasons, but having that sort of last moment with Sam really solidified her sense of belonging to Everett, you know, both of them, as sort of an honorary family member. So I guess in that sense, there is improv in that we did it, you know, we improv under the lines. And there's a creepy ram in that set that we kept saying was watching us in a way that made us, if I forgot my line, I'm like, it's the ram. Hello.
Fan.
You look really nice.
Thank you.
I mean, I can't see details because I don't have my glasses on, but the impression of you has red hair. You're just better than everyone.
So my question is, I remember my first time you in Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's a good show.
I have seen you in The Guild, and I just kind
of... Good show.
I just watched that episode when they first introduced Charlie yesterday.
Oh, so, wow. Well, So you're spoiled. You should have run screaming. I don't know what your problem is. What was my favorite? I mean, that's hard to say because I could say the ones that I didn't like. Well, I probably shouldn't say that, but they're nothing that you would probably know me from just because they were either bad or just not memorable. The shows that I've been on, like The Guild and Buffy and even Dollhouse, I did a couple episodes of that. And a great show. Eureka was an amazing show I love being on. And, you know, so every character you have to fall in love with when you do it, and if you fall in love with the character enough, then you feel like you belong there, and that creates a memory that, of being that person. So I guess my favorite role, or maybe not the favorite role, but my favorite experience was Dr. Horrible. Project. And in that, it was life-changing and life-affirming, and it was a situation where everyone was making things outside the permission, so there was a sense of freedom and play that I think only is equaled on my own sets where I'm in charge and be like, nope, we're not doing that, you know. That wasn't the case on that set. I was just lucky to be an actor on it, but there was that sense of where there is no shaming here. There is no stakes that somebody's going to fire you off the set, or there was just all about let's just make each other the best that we can be in this moment. So and I think that really translated how it impacted people, because there was a sense of freedom about it that was really wonderful. So I guess that would be my answer. I'm sorry for spoiling you. Just keep going. The episodes are worth it.
Very inspiring to me.
Thank you.
My question is about, especially the fight scenes, especially with the Good and Bad Charlie episode. You kicked ass in that episode.
Thank you.
I just want to know how you prepared for those, because they were pretty intense.
Yeah, that's a really good question. There is an amazing guy on the Supernatural set, Lou. He's the head of the fight coordination and stunt coordination, and he is a wonderful person. Like, you just want to hang out with him and trade stories. He has all the stories in the world. And when you have a fight scene, especially when it's elaborate, like in that episode, you definitely have to do a lot of rehearsal, because you don't, you know, you think a television show has a lot of time. I mean, you know, you're always rushing, and you know, everything always is very late. You're always working Friday until 3 a.m. And I don't know how the guys do it. It's just amazing their spirit and their strength and their dedication to their work. So, you know, when that fight scene came up between me and Jensen, or Dean, we rehearsed it quite a bit. And there was a stunt woman who was specialized in jujitsu, who, you know, remember the scene where I'm like putting my legs around Jensen's head, and that was cool. I was a little uncomfortable. I bought new underwear and everything, but I was worried. They were pleather pants. There's no breathing in those things. But, so she helped me with a lot of the moves of that. And the funny thing is that I'm kind of, you know, I'm not tough, like, as a person. Like, I really love being tough, because I love the dichotomy of somebody who doesn't look like they would kick ass kicking ass. I love that about genre, that we can do that. And so when we were doing that fight sequence, I kind of fall in this pattern when I get nervous of, like, you know, and Jensen was like, what are you doing? You look like you're getting sort of making fun of me a little, not in a sweet way. Like, he's like, you look like you're from the 20s. You're like, yeah, watch your fish stop. And he was totally right. I looked ridiculous. And it was very sweet, like, in a not bad way. But I got really angry. And, like, they went action. And I went, bam! And I really hit him really hard. I almost dislocated my thumb, like, I hurt for, like, months later, and I was like, well, I hope that looked cool. Anyway, he's really sweet.
Hi, Felicia.
Hello.
I'm Callie.
Hi, Callie. How are you?
I'm good. I have an ongoing bet with my ex-boyfriend that whoever meets you first gets to be your best friend.
Well, I don't remember meeting your ex-boyfriend, so I guess I get you.
I
expect
you first.
glad we established it.
So I'm an aspiring actor and writer, and my roommate and I are working on a web series. And so you've been so successful in all of that. What advice can you give to someone like me who's just starting out doing that?
Yeah, that's amazing. Congratulations for doing that. It's fantastic. I guess my advice to you is that be as great as you can be in being who you are now. Like, you're not gonna make something perfect. When I look at back at the Guild, and I actually talk about this in my book, I'm like, wow, there are a lot of rough edges in that first episode. Like, it's so low resolution because there were no HD cameras back there. Like, it looks like we're in a fog, but I know that at the time, I did the best that I could. I took all the knowledge that I had over the years from working on sets. I did my research. I looked at everything, like, how do I make this the best that I can on my resources? And I did whatever it took to make that happen. And even though everything wasn't like TV quality, it was enough because it had that spirit of like, we are all together here doing our very best. And I think that's what, that authenticity is the most important thing that you can do with your own content, whatever you're making, in video or art or anything. You need to put your imprint on it in a very authentic way, and people will recognize that. And then I guess my other advice is just, you know that it's hard to get content out there. There's a lot. And if you are, you know, in order to get, after you finish it and you know you made it the best you can, like, think really logically from a point of view of the audience. Like, if I was a person who would like this, where would I find them? And value the audience that you get, not the audience that you want. Because you shouldn't abandon the people who actually like your stuff just to sort of chase after nebulous numbers. Really, it's about the community you can build around your work that will see you through everything you do as you progress and get better and better and better. So good luck with everything. That's amazing. And keep filming. The more you do it, the better you'll get. But yeah, good luck. Wow, that's a really good question. Like I said, I love that scene with Sam where, because I think Dean was more of a big brother to Charlie. And then Sam, you know, he's so vulnerable. He has that sort of, you want to take care of him. And I think that's really one of the hearts of the show is that he is so sensitive and open to the world. And Dean just fights for him no matter what they're going through. And then in return, Sam fights for Dean. And that is really just a relationship of the ages. Like, I think it's iconic. And, I love the idea that they had the sliver of connection around Dean, because obviously Charlie cares about Dean, and seeing the depth of which their relationship was, I would have loved to have more of that. And also because Sam is so, you know, he's very capable in the hacker world. I would love to see them take something down together. And I guess, yeah, it was cool, like, that one scene I got with Cass. Like, I love Misha, and I love that character so much, and his innocence is so endearing. And I think Charlie would love to just get him drunk and leave him in a park. I mean, making sure he didn't get assaulted or something, like, or robbed, but I know, that was terrible. I know, Misha had an incident, which was terrible, I don't know the details, but my thoughts are out with him. But, well, that was awkward. But in the fictional world, I'd love for them to go out on the town, because I think they're both kind of dorky, so their idea of raging would be really funny. And then I just like her to really punch Mark Shepard.
The episode that you were both in, you didn't have a scene together.
I know!
Yeah.
And I love Mark as a person, but I just think it'd be funny for her to be like, okay, that's enough. And then go, sorry. Sorry. It's Canadian for sorry.
So in Oz time moves differently, what do you think about like a spin-off instead of about that? And would you take the
A spin-off for Charlie?
In Oz, time moves differently.
Like, I mean, at the time that was a really cool idea. I guess I'm dead now. Unless I'm a ghost there.
Wait,
like the way you think, sir. Robin, I always thought you were useless. Where I come back, I don't want to have two different characters. There was actually a couple scenes that got cut just for time with Charlie and Sam in the car, where I kind of get the lowdown on what happened in Oz. It was actually kind of a violent, dark world, and really it was Charlie's love for Dorothy, and it was a platonic love, from what I understand. But I don't really know the particulars. But she felt very deeply for Dorothy, and basically split herself in two to save her friend. And whatever extent of that relationship, it would have been interesting to kind of explore that a little bit. And also just see, you know, the badass things, because I loved how Dorothy was so kind of 30s, and I think that the vision for that world would have been really, really cool. So, you know, obviously, you never know what'll happen, but go write the fanfic, Robin. Sorry, I didn't mean to call you useless. He's leaving. He's like, out.
Alicia, love you so much.
Thank you.
How do you think a real fight between Jensen and Alicia would go?
I'd be on the floor, yo. He's so good at fight scenes. Like, half the time, like, only extreme examples does his fight double even do, you know, anything that was really would be particularly dangerous or something like, but he does most of the stunts himself, and he picks it up like that. When I was working on Buffy, and I was very new to working, Sarah Michelle Gellar, it was in the last episode, I think, and she did this thing where she had a monologue, and then she had to do like 40 moves fighting while she was doing the monologue. I think it's in the very last episode. And she didn't even come in for rehearsal. I was like, whoa, how's she gonna do this? Like, I saw her standing doing kind of the moves in the dialogue, and then her stunt double did the moves in the dialogue, and I was like, what the hell, lady? She walked in, they showed her the moves, boom, perfect one take. I'm talking like a monologue and all this fight sequence killing like four people at the same time, no rehearsal. And I guess if you're on a show for that long, you just have those reflexes. You know the character so well, and in body and mind, that you can do that. And I think that's the same thing with Jensen, you know, and Jared. So yeah, I admire watching them work. It's very inspirational, and in that they really love what they did, and they just did it 100% every time. Yeah, he would slap me.
Hi, how are you?
It's a serpent, too.
Hi, you're awesome. We
thank
love you.
You.
As you can see, you have a huge supernatural representation. So how do we get the rest of the boys to show up?
Yeah. Yeah. I have to say to a paper.
Dragon Con is the best con.
It really is. Yeah, I mean, if I see them again, I'll put in a good word. I just know they work until 3 a.m. on Fridays every night. I mean, they have a family. It's amazing what they do schedule-wise. So, but I will definitely put in a good word. I will. I'm not unhappy with what happened, but that's really interesting. No, I never got asked to be on Supernatural, and that's why when they asked me in season 7, I was like, I gotta get on here, they're gonna cancel the show. This might be my only chance, guys. In regard to what you just mentioned, I think, you know, I don't like, you know, focusing on that, but I do think that if we can all have the strength to stand up to someone who we see is doing something wrong in our general agreement, it's very hard to feel alone and stand up to people. And that's why bullying, and in my book really, is encouraging people to never be ashamed of who you are and never feel the need to suppress something that you could strengthen somebody else in your standing up for something. So in anything, online or offline, you guys' bravery, all of us together, our bravery together, being as proactively positive as some people decide to be proactive negative, will encourage more and more people to be in the light side versus the dark. I'm kind of a paladin. but thank you for saying that.
Hi, Felicia. I'm David.
Hi, David.
This is my very first DragonCon. This is my first panel.
Am I? Oh, my God!
This one is to make me drive the car 500 miles to see you in Jersey. I was the one with the magic staff. Remember that?
You mean, you what did I? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
The state of Maryland said my car won't pass emissions if you don't drive it. So I said, I can drive 500 miles to meet Felicia in New Jersey.
Oh, that's sweet.
So I had this 190-year-old magic staff. I don't know if you remember that or not.
Oh, I don't. Okay. So you were at that meeting?
Yeah, and I posted a picture and you favored it, and I got all these people.
Are you kidding?
Yeah.
What is your dragon name?
You mispronounced it last night on a couple nights ago. I'm like, I'm really the first one. I'm sorry. No,
that's okay.
You said it right the first time.
That was like 20 years ago.
My question is actually to follow up bullying. I just found your content like a Jesuit. I've been watching the Guild Dragon movie attention. But in your music video, where the cool ones now?
Yeah.
They throw you in a pool, and it looks like you never learned how to swim from your own school. How do you deal with things on set?
That's very cool. And it's cool that I mean, we're at DragonCon and I'm meeting a dragon again. So good to see you. True story, the guy I kissed in that car, he showed up to the Portland signing. And it's so, I was like, oh, are you okay with me talking about your unibrow? And he was like, yeah, it's funny. I was like, okay, good, because I made fun of myself way more. Yeah, that was such a lovely time in my life, and it's really cool. There's still an Ultimate Dragon forum on Facebook that people are pretty active on, so it's so cool to see you. What was your question? Oh, the pool. Yeah, I never learned how to swim. I can't swim to this day. If you put a pool in front of me, I would die, so don't do that. That's why I won't go on a boat. I won't go over water, and I hate heights. And I don't like small spaces, and I'm allergic to onions, and... a lot more, basically. But yeah, they had 4 people in the pool because I was so afraid of it, and I really don't like getting my face wet. Like, I'm a weirdo, guys. It's all in there. But my fear of water is not. But I like a bath. I like a jacuzzi. That's a fine body of water. It has an end. Yeah, exactly. But one year, I went to Hawaii, and I was like, I'm going to vest my fear of water. I'm going to put a snorkel mask on. I'm going to stand waist high in water. I'm going to put my face under there. And I was like, and I went under, and I literally had a panic attack. And then I went, let's go have Mai Tais. Anyway, thanks for driving. I hope you have an amazing Dragon Con. Oh, okay, good. Okay. All right. Bye-bye. I'm glad I was your first. Somebody first. Oh gosh, last question. We have some good cosplay here, though.
I also am also a Dragon Con
virgin, so it's my first. That's fantastic! And cosplay!
Yeah, I have wings, they're really big, but at the time it's ripped, so I have them, there they are!
Oh, well, okay, yeah. Those wings are hard, it's hard. If you want to pee, it's really hard. Give me that stall, come on now.
Being my first Dragon Con, there's not a lot of things that I have on my schedule. You are my number one on my schedule.
As it should be.
But I'm not, our school is not accepted for my penis, and it's hard
Yeah.
So that's hard. And what my question is how do you get past that and accept yourself for that, you know, you have so many people that you're surrounded with that aren't the same way as you are?
Yeah. Well, congratulations for being bold. And first of all, dressing up, that's amazing. Is around you right now is probably fun to hang out with and accept you exactly as you are. Really, that's why I wrote a book, is because, and I'm not trying to plug the book, but I am saying that,
I'm trying to plug the book is very good.
But there's no reason why, I think the beautiful thing about the internet is that it's allowed us to open a door to our true authentic selves and find other people who make us feel accepted. And unless you're into something really weird and illegal, like, you should embrace who you are, no matter what, except for illegal things, you know? And the wonderful thing is that we have an online world that is increasingly becoming as important as our offline world in a way that we're not confined to the people around us. And yes, we can love other people who don't have everything in common with us, especially if they're family. You're kind of, you know, that's your family. They're not going away, which is good. You don't want your family to disappear. I don't know where I'm going with this, but the wonderful thing is that there's so many communities online. Like, that's my company. Is about creating community and having people see a t-shirt on somebody else and is like, oh, hey, you know that show, and we have something in common now. And the same thing about you, Cosmic Cast, like, you're gonna be able to find people because of that thing you're wearing in a physical life, but also you can find a forum or an amazing group. Like, the Supernatural family is one of the most beautiful families, and I'm so glad to be a part of it myself. And reach out to people around you, and do more things on the Supernatural track if there are any other things, and you're gonna find some awesome people. And next year, when you talk to people and meet them online, you can meet them offline in awesome places like this, and that's why I love DragonCon.
Panel will take place downstairs in the Chastain E&D. We're gonna talk about it's sort of a 10-year retrospective of the show, so please come down and join us tomorrow if you can. It's going to be 8:30 tomorrow night.
Yay! So.